Hi everyone! Today let's take a look at a home computer from IBM's lineup that is largely forgotten now, but in the early 1990s did have its time in the spotlight. The IBM PS1. In 1990, on June 26th, IBM launched a new line of computers, targeting those who wouldn't otherwise consider themselves to be computer people. The IBM PS1 Model 2011 marked the start of IBM's second attempt to enter the home computer market, after the failure of the PC Junior launched in 1984, but following the success of IBM's PS2 business line first launched in 1987. The PS1 line targeted new consumers seeking ease of use and an all-in-one system. Early models traded specs and expandability for a lower price point and a productive experience out of the box. The PS1 presented as an all-in-one unit, coming standard with a mouse and IBM Model M2 keyboard. In this specimen, it's clear that a little tender loving care will be needed to bring them back to their former glory. The VGA monitor is unusual. It contains the PC speaker, but also the computer's only power supply option, providing a standard VGA connector beside a proprietary DA15 cable that supplies 36 volts DC to a DC-to-DC converter inside the main system unit. The Model 2011 comes with a 1.44 MB floppy drive popularised by the PS2 range, and an optional hard drive of around 30 or 40 MB. Unlike later PS1 models, it has a 286 CPU and usually 1 MB of RAM, and either a modem as standard for USA models or an RS-232 interface otherwise. Let's slide off the lid and see how this old thing looks inside. Not too bad. This machine appears relatively clean, so we'll give it a try and see if it powers on and boots up properly. First, I'll attach the two monitor cables. Then I'll plug in the keyboard and mouse, which both use the standard PS2 interface. I've attached the power, so let's hit the main power switch on the monitor and hope for the best. Listen to that old hard drive purr. Okay, so that other noise doesn't sound the best. What we see on screen are some post or power on self-test error codes, and the beeping in this case is actually caused by a keyboard fault. I've noticed with this unit that unplugging and replugging the keyboard seems to reset it and the beeping stops. We can then press F1 to dismiss the errors, and we see the machine boot into what's known as the four quadrants or four quad menu, which is actually built into the ROM of the machine along with IBM's PC-DOS version 4.01. So this is not a bad start, I've seen worse. Let's learn more about what's inside the system unit. There is a proprietary hard drive interface using an edge connector, replaced in later models with a standard IDE parallel ATA interface. The floppy disk drive also uses a proprietary cable, though it's similar to the common 34-pin connector used by standard 3.5-inch floppy drives of the later PC era. The upright board in the middle is a DC-to-DC power converter, which takes the 36 volts supplied by the monitor and converts it to the standard 12 volt and 5 volt rails common to basically all PCs. A connector resembling a PCI slot is actually a proprietary interface for an ISA expansion known as the ACU, or adapter card unit. Beside that slot is a 34-pin header connector for the PS1's optional combination audio joystick card, an add-on which is quite rare. In this unit, the RS-232 option board is fitted instead of the modem board that would be more commonly found in a USA model, and is connected by a 20-pin ribbon cable. The DB25 serial board is found at the back of the system unit. The onboard VGA chip is an IBM 15F6864 in this unit, and is accompanied by a color lookup table, otherwise known as a RAM DAC. 8 other VGA RAM chips, 4 bits each, are found scattered nearby for a total of 256 kilobytes of video RAM. This chip is a VL82C300. I don't know what it does, but it likely provides glue logic or buffering, and is part of a custom IBM chipset. If you know better, please let me know in the comments. The VL16C451A is a combination UART for RS-232 and controller for the bidirectional parallel port. More chips are found underneath this tray supporting the drives, so in a moment we'll take that out and see what else we can find. The construction of this machine is such that you can take out many of the parts by hand without needing to remove screws. After disconnecting the hard drive via its edge connector, we can release a clip at the front and slide it out. Apparently, the interface used on this drive is known as XTA, modified by IBM to include power pins, and it's an old 8-bit interface with similarities to the IDE parallel ATA interface that became the standard for many years. This drive is a MaxStor 40MB model, matching the specs of drive type 39 in the original IBM AT BIOS. The front of the machine has a removable RAM card. The model 2011 motherboard has 512KB of RAM soldered in directly, but it was common for the machine to come standard with this card that extends it by a further 512KB for a total of 1MB. The PS1's floppy drive is a design introduced with the PS2. It's very similar to the standard PC floppy drive of the 90s, but do not plug the PS1's 34-pin header connector into such a drive. It incompatibly integrates 5V and 12V intended to power the drive, and uses another pin for drive type sensing. Now that we've removed the drives, there are three screws to undo before we can remove the tray. All have a hex head with a flathead screwdriver slot for convenience. I'll take the two out the front, and then there's a third one somewhat hidden at the back of the tray. With that removed, we can easily remove the tray and see the goodies underneath. The DS1287 is a combination real-time clock and CMOS memory for storing BIOS settings, but because of the failure of its inbuilt battery, it isn't retaining its state. We'll need to do something about this to eliminate some of those error codes at boot. The IBM 64F1330 is another mystery chip. Let me know if you have any idea what it's for. Given its placement, it might even be related to hard drive control. Here we have the 10MHz 80286 CPU, in this case manufactured by AMD. There's a pair of 74ALS245 octal bus transceivers, perhaps related to the ROMs, buffering, or some other bus control. The two EPROMs total 128KB of BIOS and built-in DOS, arranged as a 16-bit wide pairing that matches the 16-bit data bus of the 286 CPU. At the front, we have the inbuilt 512KB of DRAM. There are a pair of VL82C304 chips. These might be equivalent to 82A304 address bus interfaces, effectively address buffers, but if you know more, please let me know in the comments. The floppy disk controller is the Intel N82077AA. Now let's inspect the inside of the floppy drive before we try giving that a workout in the PC. I took the lid off and didn't find too much dust or other debris, but there does appear to be some corrosion damage of a part of the PCB. It's common in drives, and in fact all computer hardware of this age, to have electrolytic capacitors that fail and sometimes leak onto the board to corrode traces, as appears to be the case in this drive. We'll probably need to do something about that to clean it up and maybe repair it. For now though, I'm going to plug the drives back in and test them out a bit. So I reinstall the drive tray and insert the drives, though I'll keep the lid off the floppy drive to see what happens inside when I try to access a disk. Everything's reattached, and I've put a floppy in before powering on to see if it tries to access the disk at all before booting. So let's power it on and watch. Though it's hard to see, initially the drive LED lights up, but without any mechanical reaction from the drive. After resetting the keyboard again and hitting F1, there's no apparent attempt to access the drive, and the 4-quad screen comes up again. From there, I go to a DOS prompt, and I try to access drive A, and it comes up with this general failure reading drive A. Note that it hasn't tried to access the drive at all, so this is some sort of electronic or full mechanical failure rather than a problem reading the disk. While we're in DOS, let's have a look around. D drive is interesting in that it's kind of a virtual drive stored in the ROM. It contains some essential boot stuff, but interestingly not the utilities that this PS1 model needs for configuring the CMOS settings. If we run the mem command, we see the basic 640K base memory and 384K extended memory. C drive is the main hard disk, and if we run the check disk command, we see that this drive has some known bad sectors. Note that this is not necessarily unusual, and early hard drives sometimes were even shipped with a label stating known bad sectors. Still, we should keep an eye on the health of a drive this age. There's nothing too interesting on this drive. Additional files making up the total PC DOS 4.01, some old documents, and then a number of games, though most of these are a fair bit older than the computer itself. For instance, there's Pango from 1983, which appears to be a CGA graphics-based rip-off of the 1982 arcade game Pengo by Sega. It seems to run a bit too fast on this machine, making it quite difficult to play. Another old game from probably the PC and XT era is Space Commanders, which is very similar to Space Invaders. This is also a CGA game, and I don't know if it too is running faster than intended on this computer, but I'm bad at it and found it frustrating. Anyway, back to work. IBM PS1 systems that came with a hard drive, like this unit, would include Microsoft Works, a simple office software suite comprising a word processor, spreadsheet, and database system. Presenting as a basic text display, it provided a windowed environment with mouse cursor support. Despite using a text-based video mode, it was still able to represent some simple rich formatting and otherwise store internal font definitions that would allow it to produce more elaborate and formatted output via a printer. Also found on this machine's hard drive are an essential pair of IBM PS1 utilities we'll later need to address the CMOS settings. The Customize utility is used to specify preferences for the startup state of the machine, how it boots, and what it should do once it's finished booting. These preferences would normally be written into the battery-backed CMOS RAM of the DS1287 RTC chip, alongside other system configuration options that would be set by the other essential, the Configure utility. While this functionality is built into newer PC BIOSes, the PS1 needs this Configure utility to show system hardware options and enable them, and ensure the CMOS settings are validated. It's complaining here about a CMOS settings fault, and to address that, we'll come back in a future video to see what we can do about the DS1287 chip. It's an obsolete part with a long-expired, non-replaceable battery, but we'll take to that with gusto, and maybe with some hacking, we can get it working again. So this IBM PS1 model 2011 works, sort of. There are some problems I'll need to take care of, and I'll start addressing those in future videos. I'll need a working floppy drive solution, or else it'll be difficult to get data into or out of this machine. I'll also make an attempt at cosmetically cleaning up the machine, seeing how I go at refurbishing the Model M2 keyboard to make it look and sound great again. I'd like to thank you for watching this video. I hope you've learned some things about this little slice of computing past. I'd also like to thank the website, ps1stuff.wordpress.com, which provides a wealth of technical and historical information about the IBM PS1 line. Please consider subscribing to my channel for future updates on this computer, as well as other projects and hobbies that I'll explore. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and feel free to comment. Thanks again.